Berks Perspectives on BCTV is supported in part by a friend of BCTV.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to Berks Perspectives. We are joined by the complete panel here. We thought we were going to be missing Fred Opalinski today, but he is with us, as you can clearly see. Hello, Fred.
Hello, good to be here.
He's been rubbing it in. He is in warmer climes as we speak, and I was telling the rest of the panel, Fred, that when I got up this morning, I thought I slept so well that it was all the way to November. I mean, it was cold.
We also have Ruth Martelli with us.
Ruth,
so that's an indication.
Ruth, say hello, Ruth.
Hello, everybody.
Martha Richardson.
Hi, everybody.
Now, she being the true professional knew what to do at that point. And John Forrester.
And good day, everybody.
Hello, and I'm still Fred Levering, and here we go. No lack of stuff to talk about. Just to kind of tidy up a small bit, last week we talked a bit about my favorite subject, the passenger train to Philadelphia, and I said that Chester County still had a vote, and lo and behold, they voted yesterday, and they, as expected, also approved. So now we got everybody on board as far as the authority is established and has the ability now to actually do things, and off we go. So that's an important step, but an entirely expected one. So good news. We haven't talked for the last few weeks about a subject that has been on our radar for a long time now, and that's the disturbance on January 6th after Inauguration Day. And Ruth keeps us on our toes of making sure we don't let that thing slip. There's been some news. So Ruth, you follow this very closely. Do you want to start us off?
Well, there's some recordings that are out there now, recording conversations between Kevin McCarthy, Steve Scalise, and
Mark Meadows.
This was the one that was just among leadership of the Republican Party. Her name escapes me. She's on the
Liz Cheney.
Eventually got kicked out of leadership. And it's been a roller coaster. Their points of view have shifted all over the place in the course of 15 months. I guess that's about how long it's been since the insurrection. Not a tour day by tourists. So now those recordings are out there, and it seems that the leadership of the Republican Conference at that point realized that President Trump had overstepped the mark, and was he and they were doing illegal stuff, including Matt Gaetz, who was saying all kinds of kind of inflammatory things. So I guess the general wisdom is that McCarthy has backtracked so that he wants to be speaker at all costs. And there are some people flamethrowing him now and other people saying, yay, Kevin, you're doing the right thing now. It doesn't matter what you said in the week after the insurrection. So all of that is there. I think the committee has finally gone after Mark Meadows come and testify and stop hiding behind privilege, which is no longer relevant. So starting now, the month is June, all of this will become public testimony, and we'll have a better picture. Whether that's going to change anybody's idea, I think John and Fredo think not.
Fred O is hoping that it will, that people will realize how significant this is. I mean, it happened with Watergate. When Watergate went public, the public's mind changed. Now, we're living in a different era. People are in their media tunnels and maybe less open to the importance of facts. That will remain to be seen.
But well, the fact is that even when presented with the actual tape, McCarthy said, I didn't say that. I mean, there it was in his own voice, you know, are you going to believe me or your lying eyes? Ears in this case. We've come to a point in our democracy, our republic, that lying is acceptable. It's an acceptable political ploy.
When the truth doesn't matter, we are in a terrible place, and it does not bode well for our future. And I hope that we come to that reckoning.
Did any of you ever think we would get to this point where we would say that? That the truth really doesn't matter? I mean,
over and over again, I'm thinking about my history and civics and problems of democracy classes from high school, where teachers assured us that our form of government, our constitution, our checks and balances would keep this kind of thing from happening. And I can't imagine, I mean, they're all long gone, but I just can't imagine what I would have done for them to see this happening. We had such faith in the strength and integrity of what put this country together.
Well, the founding fathers saw the potential for this and tried to put in as many checks and balances and guardrails as they could. And, you know, I go back to Churchill's statement, democracy is the worst form of government except for all the others.
Yeah. Or Franklin's, we've got a republic as long as we can keep it. After the Congress. At any rate, who could have imagined this level of fragility and this level of perniciousness in the leadership to do whatever they can to stay in power? I mean, you know, the peaceful transition of power was the hallmark of this country since its inception. And to see it so disregarded, and to hear these tapes about, you know, let's do this and let's do that, and to hell with the Constitution, and to hell with the rule of law, we're going to do it because we want to keep this guy in office. I mean, it's just unfathomable to me.
Well, Fred, we forget 150 years ago we had a civil war, literally. You know, brother versus brother. And the only difference is that it was there was geography involved, and there isn't this time. We are the enemy, and we've met the enemy, and they are us. They're all around us.
Yeah, the whole country.
And that's, you know, the enemy, the polarized sides view each other as the enemy.
But could I please point out that in American history, we had a trial run of states' rights. That's what the Articles of Confederation were all about. We've tried that take on American government, and it failed miserably. Because you can, and that was just 13 colonies. Now we're talking about 50 separate states, each with their, I mean, at that time, each of them had their own currency. Each of them had the privilege of charging taxes to go back and forth across borders. That was when we had a weak central government and strong states' rights. And we had to throw in the towel at that point in American history because it did not work for the benefit of everyone.
Well, the first thing we rejected was the monarchy, which some people seem to be embracing now.
But you know, two good things, not in our country, but in the bigger world. I think it was Slovenia voted to turn back the current right-wing president of that country. And France, now not by a wide margin, but France turned back an assault on their democracy from the right, somebody who's allied with Putin, and cheered the advent of the Trump government here. So there is at least some places where people are pushing back against the kind of nationalism that some people champion.
Well, and did you hear the good doctor from Kentucky? Rand Paul.
Rand Paul.
Yes, going on and on about how it's just fine for Putin to be invading these countries because they were a part of the Soviet Union. First he said Russia, and then he corrected himself. But can you imagine anybody in Congress saying that about Hitler? I mean, it's unthinkable. And
yes, and yes, it happened. It happened. It happened. First of all, it happened around here. We had Nazi pockets around Berks County.
For sure.
And Charles Lindbergh, of course, was an avid supporter of Hitler.
Hitler, yeah. No, I know it was around in America, but I mean, I just to hear Rand Paul go on and on about how there's not what's so wrong about this. Just.
Well, I understand that there were, what are they counted up, 46 Republican members of Congress who were involved to some degree in January 6th, that supportive of the concept of intercepting the vote.
Insurrection is the word.
Indeed.
Which even the right wing, even the right wing radio pundits are at least calling it a riot. They're not going so far as insurrection, but it was intended. The intention of the rioters was to stop the transfer of power, was to stop the election.
I hope there are consequences for it, because otherwise it will happen again. They will be better prepared and may well succeed.
I know.
There have been no consequences for liars. There seem to be no consequences for Kevin McCarthy. It just seems that I have to say that as I've been sitting here listening to you, for the first time I have come to think I probably agree with Fredo or with John that nothing will come of this. We are just sinking into some mire that I can't imagine how we'll ever get out of it. And I have not felt that way until right now. And I just am very depressed and frustrated about it. When the truth becomes irrelevant, when it becomes blatantly irrelevant, as it has been obviously this week, we're in deep doo-doo. For nicer.
And the sad thing is, Martha, we've known for far more than a week that lying has been the staple.
Exactly.
Government, and excuses have been made and permission has been given. Why should it stop now? And unfortunately, there are so many people who were loyal to the previous administration who was it? Mitch McConnell who said, I hope those bastards take him out, referring to the Democrats in terms of Mr. Trump. And now he said, of course he'd vote for Mr. Trump if he were to be a candidate again.
Yeah, the difference is McConnell says he hopes the Democrats take him out. When we were faced with Watergate, the previously mentioned Watergate, Barry Goldwater, who was a staunch conservative, went up to the White House and said Nixon should resign or else we'll take you out, we being Congress.
John, seriously, do you think if Ford had not pardoned Nixon, would he have gone to jail for what he did had he been tried?
No.
I don't think so.
Interesting question, though. Now, I've been listening patiently, so I have an item or two to make mention of. I said from the first day that we spoke about this incident that it was wrong. It was completely wrong, and the people that breached the Capitol deserve whatever their fate. I mean, if whatever penalties they deserve, they should get promptly, which is already taking way too long. But nevertheless, I've said from the beginning it was wrong. I've also said from the beginning that I never thought for a moment that this was somehow going to overthrow our government. No way. This is a handful of people out on the fringe. And in any group, whether it's the country in general of our 330 million fellow citizens, or it's the 435 plus 100 in the Senate, you know, 400 or 535 people in the Capitol, there are always going to be people that are out on the fringe somewhere. And there are people within Congress who I completely disagree with.
That wasn't the fringe, Fred. That was the center of the bolt of cloth.
Now, the whole thing, John, was directed at trying to eliminate Donald Trump from ever running again. I mean, it started when he upset Hillary Clinton and the so-called, they called themselves the resistance, started, that they were never going to give him any opportunity to display anything, that it was, they were directed at ending him and making sure he never did it, had any opportunity to do it again. And
who's they?
You could call it the swamp or whatever, but I mean, it's the entrenched people in Washington, the Democrats and others that just don't want to have anybody upset their apple cart, that they are going to be able to do as they see fit. And I mean, you can make faces at me all afternoon, Ruth, but it's not going to shake me. I think the whole thing was to eliminate Trump, and they made life miserable for him. He was twice impeached on bogus grounds that never were going to go anywhere. He was not convicted, as we all know. They want to make sure it never happens again. And when you look at the 2020 election, you know, was any of the items that we've talked about many times, you know, the Facebook thing with Zuckerberg and other things, were any of those in and of themselves sufficient to throw the election one way or the other? No. But when you add them all up, you do have to scratch your head and say, my God, there's a lot of coincidences here. And whether it would have amounted to anything, I don't know. But there were very clearly a lot of people that were very dedicated toward making sure that Trump never had this opportunity again. So I think
there have been investigations endlessly into by very dedicated people, public servants, to see if there was any kind of shenanigans.
But there always seems to be something else. You know, we had the Hunter Biden laptop thing. That, oh my God, that is all nonsense.
Canard.
There's nothing to it. Forget about it. Nothing to see here. And now all of a sudden it becomes relatively clear that there was something to it. And there were
only on Fox.
Oh no, that's nonsense, John. I mean, there are the contents of that laptop. There are emails amongst Biden and his son and people that work for him.
I haven't seen any.
I've read about them. I mean, go take a, you're not, you know, if you don't look for it,
please,
you're not going to find
please.
It, John.
Refer me to them.
There were visits, lots of visits to the White House while Biden was vice president and stuff by his son and these other associates, we'll call them. I mean, there is just a lot of things. And, you know, that, you know, the laptop, the money that Zuckerberg put in, you add all those things together, and any thinking person has got to say, geez, there's a lot to consider here. I believe this whole thing is directed at making sure Trump doesn't have another opportunity, and I don't think anything's going to come of it as a result.
All the circumstantial evidence amounts to is tantamount to justifying lynching the Vice President of the United States and stopping the certification of the vote.
I sincerely believe that Mr. Pence was not in danger of being hung. That's
okay.
You just
said that 47 members of the House.
No, it's 46. Oh. 46.
Okay, 46 were complicit in arranging and supporting January 6th before it happened. So how do you feel about the people in Georgia, some of Marjorie Taylor Greene's constituents, filing to keep her off of the ballot because of the violation of the oath she took to the Constitution by supporting the undermining of the election and the transfer of power? Should they be allowed, should Louie Gohmert and all the rest of those 46 people be allowed to continue in the American government?
That would be, if there's something to that, that would be for a court of law to decide, not me.
Here's the troubling thing for me, Fred. Donald Trump is, I think, inarguably the most corrupt, inept, self-serving president we've ever had. And the fact that tens of millions of people were ready to overlook all of that and bring him back for another 4 years of that is beyond comprehension for me. That his thousands and thousands of lies didn't matter to those people. That his amassing of wealth with his family because of his place in office didn't matter to the Americans. That his wish to dismantle NATO, his support of Putin, all of those things just didn't matter. I mean, I don't understand what has become of the Republican Party. They have become purely the party of Trump, and the fact that time after time there were opportunities for Republicans to step in and call it, bring us to our senses, and they refused to do it. The reason that 30 million plus people believe the lies is because Republicans failed to challenge them and went along with them because
the Republican Party, Fred, the Republican Party is a minority party. It is a minority within its own party. It's the real Republican Party, the party that stands for certain values and traditions, is out shouted by the cult of Trump.
Yeah, I don't doubt that at all.
They aren't Republicans.
They aren't.
They're not the Republicans I know.
Trump has no principle, no guiding compass except himself. And apparently that's just fine with the majority of Republicans now. It's inconceivable to me how that could have happened. How somebody whose entire life is full of deceit and manipulation and business failures and all the rest, that this guy has become a god for the majority of Republicans is just makes no sense to me at all.
For the majority of people who are standing under the Republican banner.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Right. Yeah. I agree with you.
There are Republicans who still hold, who are not members of the Trump cult.
I believe I'm one of those. I mean, I have.
I believe you. I believe you two are. Yes.
I have.
I wonder how many.
Martha.
I wonder how many of the people who are part of the Trump cult and now registered Republicans were in fact even registered to vote before he started running for office because before this television idol that put people down and became the hero for all the white nationalists who are so afraid that their majority is going to be taken over, and so afraid of this country suddenly becoming not the white nationalist country they want it to be. I wonder how many of them who suddenly felt they had a champion decided for the first time in their lives that they were going to vote. And I haven't seen any statistics on that.
But well, I believe you're right that there were significant numbers of people that Trump brought into the process, but you know, why were they not voting previously? And I mean, I believe many of them weren't voting previously because they thought they were marginalized, that nobody took them seriously, nobody listened to them. So why bother? And this was the first time they felt there was somebody listening to them.
Oh, exactly.
This happened once before with a cult of personality, and that was Ronald Reagan.
Indeed.
Yeah.
Who famously said, "I didn't leave the Democratic Party, the Democratic Party left me." However, the Reagan Democrats who left the Democratic Party were also considered themselves patriotic and were staunchly anti-communist. We don't have, you know, Reagan stood for certain things, whether you agree with him or not. But the cultist party now, the Trump cultist party, doesn't really stand for anything except against whatever the Democrats are for. And you know, even when the Democrats are for, just today, Biden announced $30 billion an arms package for the Ukraine. They're against it because, you know, they're for anything that will set a stumble block in front of Biden.
That's an interesting take also. I mean, I don't like Donald Trump's, you know, the personality, the bluster and all that stuff, but I firmly believe that my life was better in his administration than it is now. I think he did a far better job as an executive than what we have now.
What did he do?
Well, John, when was the last time you were at a gas pump? I mean, there are tremendous...
The President of the United States does not set gas prices.
He doesn't set gas prices, of course not. However, policy has a lot to do with that stuff. And was it just a coincidence, the way the stars lined up, that all of a sudden Biden starts rattling off all his executive orders and the price of gas doubles? I mean, is that a coincidence?
Well, no. I mean, yes. The price of gas is cumulative of a number of factors. Number one being the greed of the oil companies.
They have more profits now than they ever had.
How fast did the price of gasoline go up after the Russian oil embargo was announced? The next day, and we're talking about less than 10% of our oil imports.
And the United States is producing more oil now than it ever has. So, I mean, the trope that Biden has stymied oil production simply isn't true. It is all about supply and demand. It is far less about presidential decisions. And the fact that it is on a global scale, prices are set globally, not within our borders. We also happen to be in Pennsylvania, which has the second highest gas tax. Down here in Georgia, you can get gas for about $3.69. But so.
Fred,
Martha?
Fred, I'm just thinking about you. And I respect you, and I respect what you say, but when you say your life is better under Trump, think of all the people whose lives were worse under Trump and whose lives have become increasingly worse because of the hatred that he enabled, that he allowed people to spew their hatred and the divisions that he has made. The fact that if I want to hate somebody who is different than I am for whatever reason, it's perfectly okay, especially if I'm a white male. So I got half of that covered. I just cannot accept what you're saying as a national, I don't know, national feeling that we were so much better.
Well, but I think the accumulation effect of inflation, of the disaster on the southern border, I mean, I'm getting a reaction that I fully expected, so I was reluctant to even mention it to begin with. These are things that Tucker Carlson spews
at 8 o'clock on Fox, and people just suck up. You know, I'm not just going to criticize him. I will criticize Rachel Maddow too, you know, because she's doing the same thing on the other side, and increasingly so is CNN. We are woefully, as a nation, ignorant because of the lack of good news reporting.
Well, I don't consider either Carlson or Maddow my principal news sources, so it's not where I'm getting mine, John. What's that?
Nor do I.
Well, thank heavens, I knew we'd find something we agree on, so.
God, we're both Republicans, for God's sake. I mean, we've got to be able to come together on some things.
Well, I'm going to have to check your card, because sometimes I'm not so sure. But in any event, I'm joking, of course. Let's talk about some other stuff. We are good halfway through things already here. We mentioned that Macron was reelected in France, and convincingly so. And that seems to be a good thing for NATO. I think a good thing for Europe in general. I don't like what's going on over there with Putin is now beginning to do what we had talked about and feared earlier, and that's now trying to leverage their gas and oil production and use it as a way to strong arm countries that are supporting Ukraine. And that has potential bad consequences to it with, you know, the saber rattling with nukes and whatnot. I'm very concerned about that. You know, now Finland and Sweden are talking about joining NATO. They are right up against, Finland is right up against Russian territory. So there are some storm clouds on the future, I'm afraid, there. It seems to me that, you know, our ongoing support of Ukraine along with NATO is principally designed to basically weaken Russia and Putin, really. That this is not going to get replicated as time goes by. So what are your thoughts on the future? It looks to me like Russia may kind of reboot to Plan B, which is basically to overrun and then basically keep eastern Ukraine, where the principal fighting seems to be going on now. What's the panel's take on what's next over there?
All right, I'll go. I really think Russia has become a rogue state. And Putin is a serious dictator, and I think he will end up the way all dictators end up. And essentially what he's doing is going to commit suicide by cop, as we call it here, but he'll be doing suicide by NATO.
I think it's interesting too that, the impact of the stoppage of oil to Poland and other countries is happening in spring. It would have been far more frightening had it been happening in fall. But, you know, suppose what I heard was that Poland for quite a period of time has been weaning itself off of Russian oil and gas and making itself ready to, get liquid.
Liquid natural gas, right? Yeah, they put in a supply export.
Yeah. Which we can support them. And the idea of India and China continuing to want to buy Russian oil, there are no pipelines that go there. The only pipelines in existence in Russia are the pipelines that take their oil to Europe. And to send it by ship makes it incredibly expensive and also laborious to get it there. It's not as though you're there in a day. So it seems to me that economically he is far more fragile, perhaps, than he thought he was. Because what did they have other than oil and gas and terrorism? Because I think he does defend terrorists and allow them to hatch their plots in his country. Certainly poisons people at will, anybody who disagrees with him. So if we allow that form of oppression to exist, then I think we risk all of us.
He has failed miserably in what he attempted to accomplish in terms of taking over Ukraine, replacing the government. I mean, he thought that NATO would fall apart. He did not expect them to stand up to him. He probably thought the United States was too divided to have any resolve in terms of his aggression. And because we looked the other way so often before, I mean, he had reason to expect that, I suppose. But he's failed at all those parts. And I think he's going to fail economically because many of the countries that have been purchasing his fuel are resolved to do whatever they can to minimize their need for Russia. So, when the Soviet Union fell apart, a lot of us were surprised because we thought it was such a bulwark and immutable, and it was in fact fragile. And I'm hoping that 20 years of his autocratic rule, sucking the money away from the people, giving it to his cronies, that all of that is going to bring an end to Putin, and I hope sooner rather than later.
Martha, I'm sorry, go ahead, Ruth.
No, I'm just hoping that the money that we're supposed to be taking from the oligarchs is given to the Ukrainians to rebuild their country. I don't know if that will happen. But, you know, to learn that a Russian oligarch has a Mercedes-Benz limousine that's worth something like $60 million, and, you know, they don't have just one plane, they have four planes, not one yacht, but several yachts. And as you said, Fredo, at the expense of the Russian people who don't have a high standard of living at all. And it will take, to some extent, it's going to take them to say no more. And they haven't done it yet. But a lot of young people have left Russia. They left as soon as the war in Ukraine was declared, and they've gotten out. So maybe there'll be something.
It would be marvelous to use all of that treasure that we have got control of at this point to help to rebuild Ukraine, because it's going to take hundreds of billions of dollars and probably decades to reverse what what Putin has done in these few weeks.
And how come he can get outraged because a bomb landed on the Russian side of the border with Ukraine after he's pummeled that poor country almost into, in some places, oblivion?
Into oblivion, yeah.
Yeah, he's doing all kinds of antics because a shell that they fired landed in Russia. So what are the rules of war anymore? It's okay for me to decimate you, but don't you try to, you know, to take any kind of revenge on me? That's absurd.
The rules of war are very explicit. He's breaking them one by one.
Right.
Well, you know what? If you can lie every day in the United States Congress and not be called to account, why should we be surprised that somebody else in another country can lie at will and break accepted laws and norms and not have anything to face? It's discouraging.
Martha, we haven't heard from you for a couple of minutes. What are you thinking about?
No, you haven't, and I was hoping you wouldn't notice. I can't imagine a very positive result right now. I certainly hope that there really are better angels somewhere that might take over, but I don't believe in them. And I'm just kind of feeling very negative about it. I think I would love to see Sweden and Finland get into NATO. As I said last week, Ukraine is a huge country. It would be much to Putin's advantage to be able to say that he had taken back the country. And if he takes back the eastern section, which I think is definitely something that he will try to do and say that is his right to do, it will just be the beginning, and he's not going to just stop with the Ukraine because he's been allowed to do this.
He can't he can't have an ounce of claim to victory. He just can't, and I'm hoping that we and they can prevent it.
I think his back's to the wall, and you know, I'm being very pessimistic here. I think his back is to the wall. I think he's desperate. I think he will reach into his nuclear stockpile and start lobbing bombs. And when he does that, we're gonna have to reciprocate. And World War III is probably upon us.
And then nuclear winter isn't far behind for all of us.
Wow.
Those dismal programs have brought us to, Fred.
Are you feeling better now, Mark?
Boy, am I sorry I asked her any questions. Let's come back to that. I mean, we got some other stuff upon us here. We have the primary elections coming up pretty darn soon. In May, and it is almost May. Don't forget that if you are not presently registered to vote, you got to do it by the 2nd of May, which is only a few days from now,
Monday.
In order to participate in this primary. The county still is looking for poll workers, and don't forget that. And I'm sure they would be delighted to get a phone call from you that you could help out. There's some other things that I've started to read about a little bit. Now, it's not going to happen by any stretch in time for this particular election, but there's talk about the open versus closed primaries, where in an open primary you can vote for candidates from either party, and independents can participate. John, with your background, do you think there's any chance of that happening in Pennsylvania?
I don't have any feeling for it. I haven't taken the temperature of that issue yet.
Aren't we only one of 12 states that doesn't allow it? I mean, I think we're in the minority, small minority in the country.
Yeah, I believe in the two-party system, and at least two-party system. And I think I would not, if I were in the legislature, I would not vote for open primaries.
What about disenfranchising all of those independents who have become a larger and larger group? Are you saying it's just too bad they should choose a party and stick with it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Or form a third party.
I think the third party is probably even longer stretched than the open primary, but...
Well, they're libertarians, there's the Green Party, there's the Constitutional
Of course, but,
Party.
In sufficient numbers to mean anything is, I guess, what I'm driving at.
But independents are a big number, and I said not to allow them to vote in the primary seems to be just really not fair.
It just has never struck me as... being proper or whatever, that somebody could throw their vote into my party's primary and help select my party's candidate. I just never struck, I don't believe it's possible to organize it to an extent to throw it, but on the other hand, it just never seemed right to me. I don't know.
Well, my sister's take on politics in Georgia is that because they do have open primary, that it is not uncommon for folks to vote for the, if there's a strong candidate in the other party, to vote against that candidate. In other words, to try to mess up the works there. So to vote for an opposition candidate to the strongest, if I were a Republican, I would vote for a Democrat in order to take votes away from the stronger one. So it's not so much giving you a chance to vote for somebody you think is worthwhile, but to try to screw up the other side. And I guess that is a risk that you take when you've got an open primary.
The primaries are intramural. And it's when we pick our candidates for the general election, when everybody's allowed to vote. So I think it's it's our club and your club, and your club picks its players, and our club picks our players, and then we go out and play the game in November.
That's a good analogy to it. I mean, in all honesty, we've always talked about how participation, the number of people voting in primaries is a fraction of what we see in the general elections. So the idea of influencing a primary election for your own reasons, we'll call them, seems entirely possible to me. I don't know.
Are independents allowed to vote on other matters in primary? I mean, if there are other things on the ballot besides...
Yes,
like a referendum or something, yeah.
Yeah, right. So they can do that. Mm-hmm. Okay,
yes.
Right. Well, that's good. So there's at least they're not completely shut out.
They presently simply can't participate in nominating the other party's candidate. That's all.
Right.
Well, it's an interesting academic question, and Pennsylvania seems to not move real quickly on things like that. So I don't know that it's going to be resolved anytime soon. So since we last spoke, it's been pretty much finalized, apparently, that Musk is now buying Twitter. Are any of you Twitter users? I'm not.
I'm not.
No.
Nope.
John, do you?
I have. I'm not a regular Twitter user, no.
Mm-hmm.
Elon Musk is.
Well, he sure is now.
he's also figuring prominently in the Johnny Depp lawsuit with Amber Heard. Apparently, he bought Amber Heard, too.
Well, I don't know how quite to address that, but I understand that Twitter has shed a significant number of users in that there are people that are not happy with him owning the thing and don't want to play anymore. What would that, you know, how would you react to that? You know, does that mean anything?
Well, wasn't there a Republican politician who was rattling cages and saying that if anybody stood in the way of Elon Musk buying Twitter, they would have to be investigated?
I hadn't heard that.
I don't know. What I've read is that the Twitter loss of a large number of users, people just dropped their accounts. It gained Republican / right wing users and lost Democrat / left wing users. So. My take on that is that the Trump base is looking forward to seeing more. They're thinking Trump will be allowed to be back on, and they're lining up so they can be entertained by his bomb molds.
But John, he said he won't go back on Twitter. Trump did.
When did you start believing him?
Right.
I didn't say I believed him. I said he said that. Not that it was the gospel by any means.
When did that ever count?
Well, evidently to a whole heck of a lot of people in this country, John, it is gospel and it does count.
Yeah.
And that's, I think that's what we, that some of us aren't ready to disbelieve or give up on. You cannot support somebody who is a liar and a divider.
If we can go back to the Macron-Le Pen election.
Sure.
You're seeing a reversal of the extreme right-wing swing. And I'm thinking, and that's happening in several other European nations, and I believe that that's indicative of something that might be happening here too, that we might be returning to some kind of stasis.
I would love to see that happening both from the right and left extremes. If we could huddle more in the middle ground. We would be in a better place. The bigger question with the Musk issue is, should a communications network like Twitter have any, should it be absolutely free, or should there be safeguards and restrictions? And I'm very concerned about the absolute free stuff. It's freedom of, you know, every newspaper has standards. And I think the same kind of thing ought to be with these platforms. I mean, realizing you're dealing with billions of people, but there can be some way, I think, of monitoring that or of flagging likely falsehoods, or of not allowing hate speech or incendiary speech any more than you can yell fire in a movie theater. That your freedom of speech does not extend to that point where people's lives are endangered. And I don't know if Musk is really meaning that level of hands off, do and say whatever you want. But it would be a very dangerous thing if that is his intention.
Bear in mind, though, that somebody has to be that referee and decide what is permissible and what isn't, and that is always subject to some sort of abuse. But
you've got liberal papers, you've got conservative papers, but they all have standards that they think it's important to set. And I would much rather have that, again, that sort of center of gravity holding us together than to allow any wacko to say whatever they want, no matter the consequences.
But who's to say? You know, it's wrong to yell fire in a crowded theater unless there's a fire.
Yeah, right, sure, exactly right. Yes, so somebody will determine that.
Now, in our last couple of minutes here, I came across something else the other day that caught my eye. According to a poll, and I think it was a Gallup or something, I mean, a normally respected one that has some balance in there, in who they talk to, and so on. And it said that 66% of people in the United States are now backing legalization of recreational marijuana. 66%. That sounds like in political terms, John, that we'd call that a landslide. So what's the temperature of the panel here? Do we expect that marijuana is going to become legal, and it would, is this going to be strictly on a state by state basis, or can Congress do something? I don't know the answer to that. That's why I ask.
Let me ask a question for clarification. Is decriminalization the same as legalization, or are they two different?
No, they're two different things. You know, decriminalization is indicating that it's still technically against the law, but we're not going to lock you up.
Prison, yeah.
Well, one of the problems here is that it's a state by state legalization problem, and that's all right. But on the federal level, the dispensaries are not allowed to use federally insured banks.
Right.
So they have to have like cash. On the property at all times.
I would imagine, though, John, that legalization would somehow bring changes to that those kind of regulations. There's too much money involved. I mean, it's, you know, how many times have we seen things like here in Pennsylvania where they, because they were going to get a couple of tax dollars, they, you know, loosened up the laws on fireworks, and it was a bad idea. But there's just too much money involved, and, you know, what motivated that fireworks thing was simply revenue. And I can't imagine that Pennsylvania would say no, but you could go over to New Jersey or Delaware and buy all you wanted. I mean, that's doesn't seem a long-term solution. We are at that hour, so we are going to call it a day, and then we'll take a reevaluation as to whether we ever want to talk about January 6th again or not. And I'm kidding. Of course we will, Ruth. But although you'd better be nicer to me. But in any event, that's it. We're out of here. Have a great week, everybody. Thank you for joining us. And we look forward to seeing you next week. Goodbye.
Bye.
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 Berks Perspectives on BCTV is supported in part by a friend of BCTV.